and he mentioned Wallace Muhammad, and there are others. We even find some situations where the chaplains are Shia, and they teach the inmates. I would like to say there's a variety of ways you can deal with it. Some of those ways we've already mentioned. But one thing for sure, from the over a decade of experience that I have in working in the prisons, one thing I like to tell you, brothers, from my experience, you better be very careful on how you correct that. Because the situation and the conditions in those prisons are always potentially volatile. They're always potentially hot. The brothers in the prisons, in many cases, are waiting for someone to be a deviant. So they can get busy and do work, as they say. And we all know, I think some of the brothers understand what I'm saying. So you have to be very, very careful. If they think that someone is being sent into the prison to mislead them, it could be very dangerous for that chaplain. So you have to be very, very careful. As for the person who is bringing in that nonsense, the corrupted aqidah and beliefs, there are some things that you can do. Number one, this is an administrative issue. You could go to the administration and tell them, this is especially if the person is a contract chaplain or they are just a volunteer, that this particular person is teaching the inmates something that could cause a riot. That's a trick that I used one time. You can go to the administration, the warden or the superintendent of the prison, and say, this guy you have coming in here, I'm letting you know right now, these things that he's teaching are not mainstream beliefs of Islam. And if you keep allowing him to come in, you might have a full-scale riot on your hands. It might work. That might be an extreme, and Allah knows best. What you could also do is get in contact with these bodies of Muslims that have been formulated a few years ago, about 10 or 12 years ago, like the National Association of Muslim Chaplains. And you can contact some of those brothers. They're seated in New York, inshallah, and ask them to give some assistance. In short, this is a very, very difficult situation because the people who are usually qualified to go into the prisons to bring the correct belief don't want to work in those prisons. Or if they want to work in those prisons, in many cases they have to live way out in the boonies. I remember when I was working upstate New York in the prison, wallahi, I cried, literally physically cried, tears came out of my eyes, because I had no Muslims to be with in that area. The prison was so far away from the Muslims in the masjid, I was crying because I was looking through the telephone book, trying to find Muslim names. I actually went around to the surrounding towns looking for Muslims, ringing their doorbells so I can just talk to some Muslims. Because the only Muslim I had to talk to in those upstate areas was my wife or the brothers in the prison. And that's why I used to stay in the prison till 10, 11, and sometimes 12 o'clock in the morning. Because I had no camaraderie. So most people don't want to work in these prisons because they're so far out. So you have to utilize what you have. You have to utilize what you have. And if, lastly, inshallah, but not leastly, if you have a rapport with those people who are bringing in that deviance, or you know someone who has a rapport with them and they like them, then maybe you can go to them and sit down with them and discuss their beliefs and tell them, inshallah, that we want to present a certain methodology of education for the inmates. And this is something that I'm hoping one day, inshallah, and I attempted to do this about 12 years ago in New York State prisons, is to standardize the aqidah and what is taught in general for the inmates who are Muslims in this country. To make a standard aqidah and Islamic education program so that all the inmates learn the same thing. Because those people from South Africa and those people from Iran are flooding the prisons with crazy, crazy things. Crazy foolishness. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the victory and the upper hand and have those brothers and sisters who are incarcerated have people who understand, have the correct aqidah to teach them the way of our Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who deserves to be worshipped by himself.
Okay, real quickly, we're going to have one more question, and then we're going to make an announcement concerning transportation. Inshallah, the last question is, can you repeat the three questions that the Jews asked?
The three questions that the Jews asked at the behest or the bequest of the pagan Arab Quraishis was the three or the young men in the cave. Who were the young men in the cave? Dhul Qarnayn, and asked them about the ruh, the soul. The ruh, the soul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Is that the last question? وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت وحدك لا شريك لك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Just one second, brothers. Inshallah, we're going to have an emergency.